In this video, we're going to discuss the past, the present, and the future of the IT architect careers to help you maximize your architect career. Hi, my name is Michael Gibbs, and I'd like to share a little bit of history about the IT architect career and also tell you where we're going. I've been an IT architect for over 25 years. I've been a network architect, a solutions architect, an enterprise architect, and a business architect. And for me, it's been the best job in the world, and many others feel the same way. And as demand for the cloud architect and the enterprise architect roles increase, these jobs just get better every single day. And I want anyone who wants to have an incredible cloud architect or enterprise architect career, the kind of career where you wake up every day thrilled to work, where you can afford anything you desire, to have such a great career. But there's so much confusion in the architect space that I want you to know where we come from and where these architect careers are going. In this manner, you'll know exactly how to plan your architect career, and you'll know the things to learn to be poised for maximum success for the rest of your career. The cloud architects of today look at nothing like the architects of the past, and that's why the training of the past does not work today. See, in the early days, we had no architects, we had engineers. These engineers were super smart, and there were so few of them in the world that could actually make the tech work. The tech in those days was so buggy, and the resources were so limited, 1 megabyte of DRAM, anybody? That we needed the techies techie to actually make the tech work. And in those days, management did not care if the engineers could speak to others, had emotional intelligence. All they cared about in those days was that they could find people that could actually make the tech work. And back in those days, and I remember them fondly, businesses knew they needed computers, but they didn't even know why. So they would buy them and then try to figure out how to actually use them. But then the systems grew. Companies started building complex data centers and connecting them with large networks. And the tech became much more complex as there were so many more devices to manage out there. And it became very necessary to have a role for the people that knew how to put the systems together versus the people that were focused on actually building them. I was one of these first few individuals, and in the early days, we first architects were called design engineers. Now, the early engineers, those design engineers, which were really the first architects, were really technical in those days. And the design engineers were 100% focused on the tech and designing the tech. And what we all looked like and all talked like in those days were the kind of techies you see in the movies. But then everything changed. Businesses started to realize the technology provided a great competitive advantage. And then businesses realized they needed a new kind of technology professional that knew how to put the systems and the pieces and parts of the system together. And they wanted someone that knew how to make the technology work, regardless of all the pieces and parts. Companies then hired a new kind of architect called the technical architect. Now, the technical architect was pretty technical and needed both engineering and architect skills. Now, this role was about 80% engineer and about 20% architect, because that's why it was called the technical architect. And the companies would hire these folks to work with the engineers. And this could have been a lead person that would lead the engineers. It could have been a resource or a subject matter expert. And for example, I worked as a technical architect about 20 years ago. I was a multicast expert. And I would consult to other engineers and other architects across the world in IP multicast. And while the role of the technical architect still exists today, it is the lowest paying of all architect roles, and there are not a lot of these positions left. Because in today's world, the world needs a different kind of architect. Now, in approximately 2005, everything changed. What happened is businesses started to realize that technology provided a huge competitive advantage. But businesses had a problem. They had no idea how to leverage technology to maximize their business performance. Businesses either had business people or tech people, but they both spoke different language. It's kind of like English and Greek. It's hard to understand each other when you speak different languages. So businesses knew they needed somebody that could actually bridge the gap between the business people and the tech people. And that was the beginning of the solution architect role. The solution architect role was a new position, and it was a very hybrid position. The solution architect was a half business person and a half technology professional. This job was far less technical than the past, and it had to be because it required so much business knowledge and a lot of technical knowledge at the same time because it's in two different domains. You can't know everything about everything, so it became much less technical. The solutions architect almost became a liaison between the business domain and the engineering domain. Now, the solution architect doesn't touch the technology. The solution architect doesn't code. The solution architect doesn't configure, because this is not a hands-on role. Now, the vast majority of solutions architect would work for a technology vendor like a Cisco or a Microsoft or an Amazon Web Services or an IBM. And the solutions architect would work as a trusted advisor to help, say, IBM's customers be more successful, adopt better technology solutions. Then the solutions architect would basically meet with their clients, they would design the systems for the customer, and they would help sell the solution. And that's why solutions architects didn't really need hands-on skills, because they didn't touch the technology in the world. It was not their domain. The solutions architect's primary domain was finding the customer's business goals, finding the customer's business challenges and pain points, selecting and finding the appropriate technology to improve their customer's business performance, and then designing the technology in a manner that would support the organization's people, processes, and technology. The solutions architect became a critical role, and it still is today, in incredible demand. In fact, the solutions architect role is so hard to fill, it's near impossible to find a good solutions architect, that companies will hire a person without degrees, without experience, if they can find a good one. Now, if you don't believe me, please watch the video in the description below of Daniel Bosu. We trained him. He is now working as a solution architect for JPMorgan Chase. He didn't even graduate high school, but he is so good as a solutions architect, any company would be lucky to have him on their team. Now, there will always be demand for the solutions architect role, but more jobs are now becoming the cloud architect or enterprise architect role, and I'll explain why in a minute. But for now, what I need you to understand is that for the most part, the solution architect role is a single vendor's technology. For example, an AWS solutions architect designs a solution or an architecture on AWS, or an Azure solutions architect designs a solution or an architecture on Azure. Things changed, hence the role of the cloud architect. Businesses became so dependent on technology, and it became so critical for their competitive advantage and their future, that businesses knew they needed to be on someone that could only work with a single vendor, like AWS or Microsoft. And that created the new role called the cloud architect. And the cloud architect role grows every single day. Now, this role focuses on all of the network, data center, and cloud technologies. And for the most part, almost everything is in one of these environments. The cloud architect role is a highly strategic role that provides businesses a significant competitive advantage. The cloud architect really enables the businesses to plan around the best technology and failure of a cloud provider. See, here's the thing. All technology fails. And when businesses are completely dependent upon technology, if the technology fails, their business ceases to function. So by creating the cloud architect, organizations could plan around failures of a technology provider. But that's not just it. A cloud architect, because they work across cloud providers, can truly enable the businesses to adopt the best technology from each cloud provider. For example, let's say in today's world, Microsoft has the edge with artificial intelligence, and Oracle has the edge with healthcare because they purchased Cerner. The cloud architect could design a multi-cloud solution and leverage the best technology from each technology vendor. And in today's world, the cloud architect role became so much more critical, as 98% of enterprises are now multi-cloud. In today's world, as a cloud architect, it's not about knowing AWS. It's not about knowing Azure. It's about knowing the cloud and all the technologies. And that way, you can assist your organizations in building public clouds, private clouds, hybrid multi-clouds, and multi-cloud environments, so your customer or the organization can have the maximum business performance, the maximum business continuity planning, and be up and operational in any environment. Now, as the cloud architect is now focused on multi-cloud and everything associated with it, now we're dealing with 5 to 10 times the product set of a solution architect. So by very nature, the cloud architect role becomes even less technical and even more business and even more leadership oriented. Now, a cloud architect may work with solutions architects. Say, if I was a cloud architect working for a bank, I might work with solutions architects from AWS, Azure, and Google for the cloud, but I might also work with, say, Palo Alto and Cisco for my networking and security needs. So the cloud architect, because they're working with so many stakeholders, needs excellent management skills and excellent communication skills and excellent leadership skills. Now, the cloud architect role is 60 to 70% business and 30 to 40% technical. And being an architect, a modern architect, the cloud architect does not touch the technology, so there's no hands-on in this job, no coding or configuring. This job is all about business skills, technical knowledge, emotional intelligence, leadership skills, and the ability to exercise influence. And the greater the business skills for the cloud architect, the greater the cloud architect's value, and hence the greater the cloud architect's salary. Now, this is a wonderful role. And again, it's near impossible to find a really great cloud architect because of the blend of both business and technical skills. Now, the last architect role we will discuss today is the enterprise architect role. And the enterprise architect role is kind of the royalty of all architect roles. And it's kind of the natural evolution of a cloud architect role. The enterprise architect is essentially a cloud architect, but now it's every kind of technology, not just the technology that sits on the cloud. So the enterprise architect will focus on the business's applications, their cloud systems, their security systems, their network systems, their artificial intelligence, any tech that the organization has to maximize their business performance. Now, once you reach enterprise architect level, it will be impossible to learn every one of these technologies, even in 10 lifetimes. So the enterprise architect becomes, in essence, a business executive. The enterprise architect is a business executive that understands technology and the business and the technology's impact in the business. And it's not that much different in what they do with what a good CIO or chief information officer would do. Now, the enterprise architect role is an executive, and it's about 80% business, 20% technology. Now, in many cases, the enterprise architect is a liaison between the chief information officer and solution architects or engineers working for the organization. Often the enterprise architect is a consulting architect, but here's the thing. It's a business role, and it's relatively close to the C-suite, and it interacts with the C-suite, like the CIO or the CEO or the CFO, constantly. Because of this, the enterprise architect role takes the most business acumen, either from, say, a master's in business, or a lot of leadership experience, or just plain old-fashioned leadership education, but this is a business role. And of all the architect roles I've ever had, this is the one that I've loved the absolute most. Now you know the past, present of the architects. Now let's discuss what we feel is the future of the architect role. We feel the architect role is going to get bigger, bigger, and bigger, and much more critical. And here's why. New technologies are created every single day. And these technologies can truly provide business value. Whether the new technology be artificial intelligence or something else, the architect is the person that helps those businesses leverage these technologies for maximum performance. So the architect role, we feel, will get bigger and bigger and bigger as more technologies come out there. It is going to be the architect that knows how to tie these new technologies to the business. What makes the architect role so special is the human side of the role. The architect, for example, may need to lead a team of 20 additional architects. The enterprise architect or a cloud architect has to match the business needs to a technology solution. The architect will have to manage stakeholders and obtain key information from stakeholders and manage stakeholder expectations. The architect of the future has more and more business skills, more and more emotional intelligence, more and more leadership skills. And by the way, these are the special skills that make us human, that make us near impossible to replace with artificial intelligence technologies. Now, hopefully you know why you can't build an architecture career by learning to code or configure, because it's not our job. And hopefully now you know why it's so critical to develop your business acumen, leadership skills, and people skills to build an elite architecture career. One thing that I can tell you after being an architect for over 25 years is that it's the best job of my life, and I would not trade these 25 years for everything. Now, if you want to get your first cloud architect job, please attend our free webinar and download the free How to Become an Architect guide. And the link is in the description of this video. And while we're at it, in the description of this video, we have so many free resources to help you maximize your technology career. And please remember to like this video, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell so you can be informed of new videos to help you maximize your IT or your architect career. This is Mike Gibbs. I look forward to seeing you in another video. Take care.